Starting in a few seconds, actually, so I'm so sorry to interrupt the discussion. Selamat sore semuanya. Good afternoon and everyone, and welcome for everyone who has joined us today on Eagle Forum. And thank you for all the participants who have registered and joined with us today. And as you can see from the chat box, for every one of you who has registered, please click on the link because from there you can retrieve your e-certificates. And I would like to first introduce myself. My name is Sarah Wayne, and I will be moderating this discussion for today on Eagle Forum and commemorating Indonesian National Film Day, celebrating the 100 years of our Indonesian film industry's founding father, Usmar Ismail, and also honoring Usmar Ismail's spirit of Merdeka Cinema and celebrating Asian diversity. We plan on continuing his legacy by inviting all of you, our participants today, and also filmmakers all across Asia to collaborate with us, starting with the discussion that we'll be having at this forum today. And as an information, before we start our discussion, this discussion will be held in English. And for those of you, we don't worry because we have an interpreter with us, Yulia Hakim, who will be helping us interpret and also translating from Bahasa to English and also English to Bahasa. And before we start, we would like to give you a little description and also introduction regarding Eagle Forum itself. Eagle Forum is a talk show program initiated by Eagle Institute Indonesia Metro TV based on digital or live streaming with various topics that invites filmmakers, academics, and also public figures. This talk show is also held live and you can access it through Eagle Awards YouTube channel and also live streaming. For 16 years, Eagle Institute Indonesia has continued and also managed to consistently support and promote Indonesian film industry, especially regarding documentary films. And with today's forum, we hope to obtain new inputs, insights, and also views on how we can continue to support the film industry, not just nationally, but also internationally. And today's discussion theme will be regarding Indonesia, film, and the spirit of Asian diversity, where we will discuss about Indonesia's potential in making a regional or even an international film festival collaboration. So without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, we have our keynote speakers for today who have joined us. Let me first introduce them. We have here the first speaker is Philip Chia, a film critic and also NetPAC Advisory Council. Good afternoon, Philip.
Yeah. Hi, Sarah.
Hi,
Louis.
Hi.
How are you?
Okay, fine.
Okay, so that is our first speaker, ladies and gentlemen. And our second speaker who has joined us today is Pak Uwe Haji Saari, a Malaysian filmmaker and also Indonesian film expert. Good afternoon, Pak Uwe. How are you?
Hello. Yeah, I'm a Malaysian filmmaker. I don't know about film. Indonesian film expert.
Well, at least you have so many expertise and also your pengalaman baik banget, Pak Uwe. Jadi we hope to gain more insights from you as well. So that is our speakers for today's discussion, ladies and gentlemen. And today we have also been joined by a set of panelists. So I would also like to mention our panelists who have joined with us today for our discussion. The first panelist is Mas Jamaluddin Pona from the Aceh Documentary Competition, Mas Belo Taran from the Toraja Film Festival, Mas Taufan Agustian Prakoso, Borneo Film Festival, and Ms. Bernard Koten, filmmaker as well, and these are all alumni of Eagle Awards. And there we also have, aside from the Eagle Awards alumni, we also have Mbak Francisca Prihadi, who is the program director of Mini Kino Film Week, Mas Budi Irawanto from the festival president of JAF NetPAC, Mbak Pirina Vindiarta from the cultural affairs specialist of the US Embassy Jakarta. Hello, Mas Budi, we can see you from here from your camera. And also we have Mbak Swastika Nohara, film scriptwriter and also a lecturer from BINUS University. So there we go. We have each panelist opening up their cameras. Hello, panelists. Good afternoon. And now that was our keynote speakers and also our panelists who have joined with us today. And don't worry, to all the participants, you will be able to have a discussion as well. You can ask the questions you would like to ask both to our speakers and also our panelists by typing in your questions in the chat box and stating your name, institution, and also the question and to whom the question is addressed to. And to start our forum for today, we would like to invite everyone to take a photo together virtually. So I would like to invite everyone to please open up your cameras so our committee can take a picture of everyone who has joined with us today this afternoon. So please do open your camera so we can take a picture. Usually we have this at the end of the discussion, but do not worry. We will be having a photo session at the beginning. So
Oke, okay. Selamat sore dan selamat datang semuanya yang sudah bergabung dengan kami dalam Eagle Forum. Terima kasih kepada partisipan yang sudah register dan bergabung dengan kami. Dalam perayaan 100 tahun terhadap Bapak film di Indonesia, Usmar Ismail, juga menghormati Usmar menghormati semangat Usmar Ismail dalam Merdeka Sinema dan merayakan Asian Diversity. Kami merencanakan untuk melanjutkan warisannya dalam mengundang kalian semuanya untuk berpartisipasi dengan kami hari ini. Dan semua filmmaker di seluruh Asia untuk berkolaborasi dengan kami, dimulai dengan diskusi di dalam forum hari ini. Sedikit background dalam Eagle Forum ini berupa program talk show yang dimulai dengan dari Eagle Institute Indonesia Metro TV. Yang didasari oleh digital dan live streaming dengan berbagai topik dan untuk mengundang filmmakers dan akademik dan serta public figures. Talk show ini juga diadakan secara live di kanal YouTube Eagle Awards. Selama 16 tahun, Eagle Institute Indonesia telah melanjutkan mendukung secara konsisten dalam industri film, khususnya dalam film dokumenter. Dengan forum hari ini, kami harap untuk mendapatkan input baru dan sudut pandang baru bagaimana untuk tetap mendukung industri film, tidak hanya secara nasional, tapi juga internasional. Dan tema diskusi hari ini adalah Indonesia Film dan The Spirit of Asian Diversity, yang dimana kita akan membahas potensi dari Indonesia dalam pembuatan film secara regional atau internasional, dan bagaimana kolaborasi dalam film festival. Dan pembaca keynote hari ini kita sedang mengetahui Bapak Philip Shah dan Film Critic dan Advisory Council, dan Bapak Iwe Haji Sari, Malaysian Filmmaker and Indonesian Film Expert, beserta beberapa panelis, Mas Jamaluddin Fona, Aceh Documentary Competition, Mas Belo Taran, Toraja Film Festival, Mas Taufan Agustian Prakosa, Borneo Film Festival, Mas Bernard Koten, Filmmaker, Mbak Francisca Prihadi, Program Director of Mini Kino Film Week, Mas Budi Irawanto, Festival President Jack Netpak, Mbak Pirina Sindiarta, Cultural Affairs Specialist of the US Embassy Jakarta, Mbak Swastika Nohara, Film Scriptwriter, and lecturer dan lecturer dari Universitas Binus.
Okay, terima kasih Yulia for interpreting our opening. And once again, we will be taking a picture together. So I would like to invite, saya ingin mengundang semuanya untuk bisa membuka kamera. So to all the participants, please do open your camera for just a few moments, for we will be taking a picture together. So I will ask some question, and I will ask help from the committee as well to make sure everyone is ready. You may prepare yourself, maybe have your hair neat and tidy just for a second before closing your camera again and following today's discussion. And there will be about how many more to be opening their cameras? So from the committee, are we ready? Ready? So I will count down for our picture, our virtual picture together in 3, 2, 1. So we're going to take another screenshot. So bear with me, please, just for a few minutes. Please keep smiling for just a few more seconds in 3, 2, 1. All right, everyone, thank you very much. You may now close your camera again. You may now sit back, relax, and enjoy the discussion. And before we start discussion and before we start our talk show, we have a video highlighting and also commemorating Indonesian National Film Day for you all to watch.
Lebih dari 1,5 dasawarsa, Eagle Institute Indonesia telah melahirkan senias-senias muda dari berbagai pelosok negeri yang telah mengukir prestasi di tingkat nasional maupun Institute Indonesia senantiasa memegang komitmen membangun dan menguatkan sinema Indonesia dan turut mewarnai keanekaragaman Taman Sari Sinema Dunia. Selamat merayakan Hari Film Nasional. Jaya negeriku, jaya sinema Indonesiaku, merdeka!
So, jayalah. And ladies and gentlemen, we will start the discussion for today this afternoon, and we will start by having our first speaker here today. Good afternoon, Philip.
Yep. Hi, Sarah. Okay. Yes.
Before we jump into your presentation, Philip, I would like to give a short, brief introduction to everyone here regarding your short bio. Philip Chia is a film critic and is the editor of Big O, Singapore's only independent pop culture publication. He is joint president of Network for the Promotion of Asia Pacific Cinema and is currently program consultant for the Jogja NetPAC Asian Film Festival, Hanoi International Film Festival, Jaffna International Film Festival, Asiatic Mediale, and Shanghai International Film Festival. He co-founded the Southeast Asian Film Festival and the Asia Pacific Screen Lab and is the patron of the Southeast Asia Screen Academy in Makassar, Indonesia. He is also the co-editor of the books Garin Nugroho and The Moon Dances, Noel Vera, Critic After Dark, and Ngo Phung Lam, Modernity and Nationality in Vietnamese Cinema. He was given an honorary award at the 15th Cinemalaya Independent Film Festival 2019, an award for achievement in the promotion of Kyrgyz film by the Kyrgyzstan Film Critics in 2010, an award for promoting Vietnamese film by the Vietnam Cinema Association in 2008, an award for Asian cinema at the 8th Cinemanila International Film Festival in 2006, and the Korean Cinema Award at the 9th Busan International Film Festival 2004.
Hirsha adalah kritik film dan juga editor Big O, satu-satunya publikasi independen pop di Singapura. Ia juga seorang joint president dalam network untuk promosi Asian Pacific Cinema atau NETCAC, dan seorang consultant program kepada Jogja NETCAC Asian Film Festival, Hanoi International Film Festival, Jaffna International Film Festival, Asia Tiga Medial, and Shanghai International Film Festival. Dia juga penemu dari Southeast Asia Film Festival dan Asia Pacific Screen Lab, dan patron dari Southeast Asia Screen Academy di Makassar, Indonesia. Ia juga seorang co-editor terhadap buku Gary Nugroho, And the Moon Dances, Mel Vera, Critic After Dark, dan Ngopong Lan, Modernity and Nationality di Cinema Vietnamese. Dia juga diberikan honorary award yang ke-15 pada Cinemalaya Independent Film Festival tahun 2019, dan penghargaan terhadap achievement-nya di promotion of Kyrgyz film by Kyrgyzstan Film Critics pada tahun 2010, dan penghargaan dalam mempromosikan film-film Vietnamese oleh Vietnam Cinema Association pada tahun 2008, dan penghargaan untuk Asian Cinema dalam Cinema Nila International Film Festival yang ke-8 pada tahun 2006, dan Korean Cinema Award at yang ke-9 pada Busan International Film Festival tahun 2004.
So without further ado, Philip, please do share your experiences and your insights, especially regarding Indonesia's film potential.
Yeah, okay. So I really apologize that you had to hear that twice. And happy 100th Indonesian National Film Day. Usmar Ismail has always meant to me to be someone who fought for the independence of Indonesian cinema. And I think that in many ways, the struggle has never stopped. He's also inspired me, and I guess I've always struggled also against the cultural imbalance that I see around in how, you know, Asian films are going out into the world. For example, since last year, I've struggled to find Asian festivals who would be interested to show the films of the Indonesian documentary director Shalahuddin Siriga. His two latest films, A Boarding School from 2020 and A Song for My Children from 2019, I think are very striking and important portraits of Indonesia. In the former film, we see how in an Islamic boarding school, the students aren't told what to think, but how to think, and they're encouraged to show tolerance towards other religions and non-believers. This mixed school also endorses equality between men and women, drawing its justification from the Quran. As the opening film titles explain, this type of Islam taught here has been practiced in Indonesia for centuries, but is under threat from rising conservatism. In the other film, we see an elderly choir group that uses the power of music to engage young audiences, to give them a sense of the forgotten history of the massive political killings in 1965. Silence for more than 50 years, some of the survivors from the 65 tragedy are singing songs that were written in prison. These songs are meant to heal their trauma. You know, many years later, or many years before, 10 years in fact, in 2010, I had the same problem with the film of Daniel Rudy Hayanto. It was, to me, a very important film called Prison in Paradise, and I couldn't get any festival to take this film. I finally managed to show it a year later at the Cinema Digital Seoul when I worked there as a programmer. This film is special because it had an amazing and exclusive 7 hours of interview footage when the Bali bombers were in jail. But the film refrained from judgment. It showed their families and children. It showed how life is often stranger than fiction. In many cases, this film was overlooked by foreign programmers because they felt that the filmmaker didn't make a judgment. There are many important Indonesian documentary directors such as Tony Trimasanto, Yuda Kurniawan, but there are only 4 documentary film festivals in this big country of Indonesia. The FFD in Yogyakarta, the Aceh Doko Film Fest, the Archipel in Jakarta for experimental docos, and the Solo Documentary Festival. I feel that film festivals are hub for connectivity in the pre-internet world, and they still do a pretty good job in getting professionals to meet each other and know each other. But it's crucial that festivals have the budget to invite people in a very old school way. People normally understand a country better when they've set foot in it, tasted the cuisine, heard the sounds, experienced the culture. So please, let's have more Indonesian documentary film festivals. Thank you.
Thank you, Philip. Let's have more Indonesian film festivals and documentary film festivals. And that's what we wish to achieve as well. And as you mentioned as well, Salahuddin Siregrat, we are very proud of him because he is also an alumni of Eagle Awards of 2005. So yes, we will be talking more with Philip regarding how we can promote Indonesian documentary films as we all wish. But before that, we would like to present and also allow Pak Uwe to share a little of his experience with us today, especially regarding Indonesian films and the potential and from what we can do in his point of view. So without further ado, Pak Uwe, please do share your insights with us.
Hi, firstly, I would like to congratulate on the National Film Day, and definitely it's very inspiring and makes more reason for us to do films. And in this, in our case here, it's a documentary filmmaker. And it, just let me, I guess, see the reason why we should have more film or documentary films here. Easily, like I've been mentioned, or I'm sure everybody knows, is because of the, there's a 3 reasons here. One, here there, we have a lot of stories to tell in this region, especially Indonesia. They are so full of stories from the, like I said, from the folklore to the legend to whatever. There are a lot of stories, number one. So we have abundant of stories to tell. Number two, as a filmmaker, we are now easily accessed to equipments, and most of the equipments are available here. So again, that's the reason that more we can easily shoot those films that we are able to tell. And the third is the last part is the market. We do have the market because this area is densely populated. So we have these 3 reasons, I think, and specifically Indonesia, we have stories, we have facilities, and we have markets. So there's no reason that why films are not made more here. But then the question is what we are trying to get is, where are we going to screen this, especially documentary filmmaker making. So one of the ways are...
Okay, but wait, before we jump into how we can have all of our films to be presented and to be screened, I would like to present a short biography and also read a little about the description of your experiences with everyone here. Pak Uwe Haji Saari is a Malaysian film director. He first gained international attention with The Arsonist, more known by its Malay name, Kaki Bakar, the first Malaysian film to enter the Cannes Film Festival in 1995. And Pak Wei began his career as a director for television dramas until 1996, when he made his film debut with the highly controversial Perempuan Istri Dan, which won him the Best Director Award at the 11th Malaysia Film Festival. In 2014, Pak Wei produced a period film titled Hanyut, and as a co-production between countries Indonesia, Malaysia, and Australia. The film is based on a Joseph Conrad's novel titled Almayer's Folly, which tells about the life of the Malay community in the 19th century. So, Pak Wei, you have mentioned the three reasons why there are no reasons in not having movies or films to be presented or to be told. Because we have the market, as you said, we have stories to be told, but how can we achieve it, Pak Wei? How can we promote it?
Yeah, so the issue now is where are we going to screen it? And that's where film festivals start coming in. People more realize that documentaries are part of us, are very important in filmmaking. And if as a member, the last time I was in Sundance, emphasis was made, even in US, the importance of a documentary filmmaker. And when I see some of the things being produced here, and I knew that we have a lot also a lot of stories to tell. And there are in Malaysia where I'm living now. There's one film festival, the AIFA, the ASEAN International Film Festival, that have a segment of showing documentary filmmaking. So, and we've always been encouraging. We always encourage the films of documentary films to be made and to be shown specifically for that genre category. So. One way is we not only we have more films, but there's more avenues to be screened, and we know that the mainstream cinema do not really carry those documentary films, except the outlets will be a film festival, and over here there are. Quote-unquote indie film festivals like Freedom Film Festival there where they cater on especially on documentary. Yeah, so we still need festivals to show our films.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yep. Important are one of the best ways to screen our documentaries and also present them to the larger audience. And before we start talking and asking more about your views and also Philip's views, we would like to ask first our panelists who have joined us with us today, who have also held their own festivals. Most of them has held their local documentary competitions and also film festivals. We'd like to know more about their insights, especially regarding our need for more festivals and more platforms to screen and also promote our documentaries, especially to share the stories. So I would like to first ask, probably from our Eagle Awards alumni, Mas Jamaluddin Pona, who is joining us with today through Zoom. Selamat sore, Mas Jamaluddin.
Halo, selamat sore.
Yes.
Halo, selamat sore, Mbak.
Selamat sore.
Halo, selamat sore.
Mungkin bisa dibagikan mungkin pandangannya, mungkin terutama terkait mempromosikan film dokumenter yang sangat dibutuhkan sebagai Philip dan Pak.
Iya, baik.
Ya, salam semuanya. Thank you so much for the work dan mau impact saya dan semua kami di Aceh, tepatnya satu provinsi paling ujung di Sumatera, dan sangat dekat dengan Pak Wei ya, dengan Malaysia dan juga dekat malah dengan juga jadi kami di Aceh selama ini memang fokus pada Halo, halo. Suara cukup jelas.
Bisa di mikrofon Pak Jamal?
Mbak Sarah boleh skip yang dulu yang lain dulu sama.
Baik, Mas Jamal, kita akan coba ini because we have some opportunities, we see Tumas Belotaran who has also helped manage Toraja Film Festival. We'd like to ask his experience as well. Good afternoon, Mas Belo. Once again, I would like to ask Mas Belo. There we are. Mas Belo, good afternoon, Mas Belo.
Kalau Toraja sudah selamat malam ini.
Oh, di situ sudah malam ya. Dia lihat sudah jam ini udah di sini 5:30 udah gelap. Ya, Mas Belo bisa diceritakan ataupun dibagikan pengalamannya terutama terkait dengan untuk Toraja Film Festival seperti apa pengalamannya, apa saja kendalanya dan potensinya yang kita miliki di daerah-daerah seperti apa, Mas Belo?
Terima kasih Mbak Sarah ya. Ya, teman-teman semua, Bapak Ibu, kalau di Toraja Film Festival yang kita hadapi persoalan utama di Toraja, khususnya kita di luar daerah mengenai keterbatasan sumber daya manusia. Nah, ini yang paling kendala paling mendasar yang kami hadapi. Nah, selain itu dukungan-dukungan dari pemerintah memang kurang maksimal sehingga membuat teman-teman yang melaksanakan festival ini berupaya untuk melakukan dukungan-dukungan dari luar. Secara pengembangan sumber daya manusia, antusias dari generasi muda ini sangat sangat tinggi. Terbukti dengan adanya festival yang kami laksanakan ini sangat dinanti-nantikan oleh generasi muda, khususnya generasi muda Toraja. Di tengah pandemi COVID-19 yang seharusnya kan kami laksanakan di tahun 2020 festival ini, oleh karena pandemi ini kami nggak bisa melaksanakan. Dan begitu banyak generasi yang mempertanyakan itu. Nah, mengenai potensi yang menunjang terlaksananya festival film yang ada di Toraja, antusias masyarakat Toraja untuk mendukung festival ini sangat luar biasa. Jadi suksesnya festival film pertama dan kedua itu karena didukung oleh Toraja Toraja diaspora yang sukses di luar, ada kecintaan untuk membangun kampung halaman. Itu salah satu kekuatan terbesar untuk melaksanakan festival. Mungkin itu saja dulu dari saya, dari kami Toraja, dari Toraja, mengenai potensi-potensi yang bisa kami sharing dengan beberapa teman-teman. Terima kasih.
Baik, sama-sama, terima kasih juga Mas Belo sudah membagikan insight-nya. Maybe for Pak UM Philip, Mas Belo has mentioned about his experiences, especially in Toraja. He mentioned the challenges that he faced, especially in holding these festivals, are the human resources, although he mentions the high enthusiasm, especially regarding the youth there. But then again, one of the other challenges that he faces is because the lack of the government support. Probably you can share your views regarding this and how we can achieve more support, external support, especially in terms of funding. And also one of the other issues that he is facing right now that is being faced globally is regarding to the COVID-19 pandemic. We will be asking more regarding these challenges that is being faced by Mas Belo and his fellow friends in Toraja. But before that, we would like to also ask the views that can be shared by Mas Taufan Agustian Prakoso, who also has experiences in holding a film festival in Borneo. Borneo Film Festival, to be exact. So, selamat sore waktu Jakarta, Mas Taufan.
Halo, selamat sore Mbak Cara, selamat sore semuanya. Mr. Yeah. Philip, Pak Wei, terima kasih sudah diundang di Eagle Institute Forum.
Silakan Mas Taufan, untuk mungkin bisa komentarnya, pengalamannya, bisa langsung disampaikan kepada Philip dan juga
Wei. Perkenalkan, saya Taufan. Sebelumnya saya agak klarifikasi dulu bahwasanya waktu di Borneo Environmental Film Festival, saya sebagai inisiator yang kemudian diteruskan oleh kawan-kawan di Kalimantan melalui Yayasan Borneo Documentary. Kenapa kemudian kita menginisiasi satu festival bertema lingkungan? Karena pada saat itu memang saya sebagai dokumenteris banyak sekali mengerjakan film-film bertema lingkungan. Itu yang pertama. Kemudian kami berpikir, saya juga kontak dengan Jamal, dengan Belo, mungkin ke depan di Indonesia dengan berbagai potensi yang sangat luar biasa yang tadi seperti dikatakan, banyak sekali temanya, kemudian ya intinya banyak yang bisa diceritakan mulai dokumenter gitu. Tapi kenapa tidak kita yang di Indonesia sendiri ini mulai sadar ketika merancang sebuah festival itu adalah sebuah sikap, itu catatannya. Artinya sikap seperti apa? Ketika saya diskusi sama Belo, Toraja Film Festival, mungkin premisnya adalah bicara tentang film-film kebudayaan. Jadi di Toraja akan menjadi etalase film-film Indonesia atau bahkan Asia yang bertema tentang tradisi dan budaya. Kemudian di Aceh dengan persoalan-persoalan sosialnya gitu ya. Nah kemudian persoalan film lingkungan ini jarang yang mau merayakan karena memang kesannya kan selalu underground. Dari situlah kami coba menginisiasi satu festival yang kami gelar sangat sederhana di Pangkalambun, bahkan tidak di pusat Kalimantan Tengah begitu. Kenapa kita memilih Pangkalambun? Karena memang di Pangkalambun ini salah satu wilayah yang menjadi konsentrasi konservasi internasional, termasuk ada konservasi orang hutan tertua itu ada di Pangkalambun. Kenapa kita kemudian di situ? Nah, ke depan kami juga menginisiasi, jadi ketika bertemu kawan-kawan di setiap wilayah, mencoba menggali kemudian apa yang akan menjadi sikap wilayah itu untuk menjadi premis sebuah festival. Nah, ke depan ini kita sedang merancang tourism film festival. Jadi mungkin di Indonesia akan sangat beragam nanti sesuai dengan tema-tema filmnya. Mungkin itu sih yang bisa kami share dari pengalaman selama ini. Matur nuwun, terima kasih.
Terima kasih, Mas Taufan. So, Pak Wei and Philip, Mas Taufan has shared that for the Borneo Film Festival, they highlighted the environment issues, which in Mas Taufan's opinion is quite an quote-unquote underdog theme. So probably we can talk about later on how to promote and probably twist unpopular themes and how we can gain interest, especially from the public. And from Mas Taufan's eyes, through documentary movies or documentary films, this can also become the face of Indonesia, promoting our country's cultural and also our environmental richness to the world. And he also mentions that the importance of documentary movies can also be an answer, and especially in helping many countries and also areas, especially rural areas, to promote their needs. That is why in the future and right now, he and his colleagues are focusing on tourism festivals, tourism film festivals as well. So that is his hopes and wish for the potential of Indonesia, especially the Borneo film, documentary film industry. But before we jump into Mas Taufan's comments and also themes of discussion, we would also like to let Mas Bernard Koten, who is also a filmmaker and an Eagle Awards alumni, to present his views and share his experiences with us today. Good afternoon. Selamat sore, Mas Bernard.
Yeah, selamat sore. Malam, kami malam. Sudah jam 8. Oh,
sudah malam, Mas Bernard. Sudah 8. Waduh, luar biasa. Terima kasih sudah bergabung malam-malam. Semoga tidak mengantuk ya, Mas Bernard. Udah kucuk-kucuk mata di sana. Mas Bernard, silahkan. Bagaimana pengalamannya dan bagaimana antusiasme teman-teman di sana, Mas Bernard, terkait dengan film dokumenter?
Baik. Terima kasih atas kesempatan dari teman-teman IGEL untuk menggabungkan saya dalam sharing pengalaman kami di Papua. Memang beberapa kali teman-teman di Papua sudah mengikuti IGEL Award yang dilakukan hampir setiap tahun. Saya sendiri dengan teman Yosef, kami terlibat di tahun 2018 dengan film Menabur Benih di Lumpur Asmat. Itu film cerita tentang soal pendidikan dan bagaimana usaha masyarakat di sana. Terkait dengan kalau kami di Papua sendiri, saya sendiri terlibat di komunitas Papuan Voices. Salah satu komunitas yang memang satu-satunya, masih satu-satunya komunitas yang melaksanakan festival film Papua, itu film dokumenter. Kami mulai dari tahun 2017, terakhir di tahun 2019. Tahun 2020 rencana mau bikin, tapi corona atau COVID ini kita batalkan rencana. Kami laksanakan secara online di tahun ini. Mudah-mudahan bisa terlaksana. Untuk kami, bagi kami film sendiri, di kami Papuan Voices ini sendiri, film sendiri itu menjadi media perubahan. Kami tidak, kalau hasil atau produksi-produksi teman-teman Papuan Voices dibandingkan dengan teman-teman yang di luar mungkin kalah jauh, karena soal peralatan apa semua itu kami masih sangat jauh di bawah. Tetapi kami menginginkan bahwa cerita itu benar-benar orang Papua sendiri bercerita, tanpa ada satu dua hal yang kita setting atau apa sana sini. Jadi memang film-film yang dihasilkan oleh teman-teman Papuan Voices yang dilakukan dan juga ditampilkan dalam diskusi atau nonton di selain Festival Film Papua, itu benar-benar cerita dari orang-orang kecil, masyarakat Papua sendiri bercerita. Cerita apa saja, soal persoalan mereka atau soal keberhasilan atau pergumulan mereka. Di situ kami memberikan ruang yang cukup besar bagi mereka untuk bercerita saja tentang mereka punya hidup. Kami Papuan Voice melihat di situ film menjadi media sebagai memberitahukan ke orang luar dan juga menjadi media penyadaran bagi masyarakat adat Papua itu sendiri. Mungkin itu saja, Kak. Terima kasih.
Terima kasih sekali. Thank you, Mas Bernard. Mas Bernard has mentioned about holding or trying to hold online festivals, especially in the time of pandemics. We'll be asking more about that with Pak Uwe, also Philip. And then he also mentioned about the difficulties, especially in retrieving or finding equipments for those, because he is in Papua, the far east of Indonesia. And he's also taken pride of sharing of how local stories can be shared through documentaries by local people as well. So that is what he has wished and also hoped, and that is what he is working on right now. So next, we will also like to ask probably a short insight from Mbak Francisca Prihadi, who is a program director of Mini Kino Film Week. Selamat sore, Mbak Francisca.
Hi. I was just dropping links. Nice to see Papuan Voices. Hi, Philip. Hi, Uwe. When listening to your presentation about promoting documentaries in festivals, I totally agree. And I think one of the keys are collaboration between festivals, program exchange, and I think it's the most crucial. And actually, the pandemic sort of opening up new possibilities when festivals are more concentrating on physical film festivals, which Mini Kino still concentrate. And we are very lucky that we can still do a physical film festival and also online discussions last year. But opening the heart and the opportunity to actually do more online collaboration, I think it's a really, really good chance. Will be a very good possibility in the coming years. So besides collaboration between festivals, Mini Kino Film Week, and of course Mini Kino, we have several festivals along the year. We show short films, maximum duration 25 minutes, and also including documentaries, of course. And promoting documentaries, well, not only through festivals, but we also do workshops. Last February, we did a collaboration with Yamagata International Documentary Film Festivals for their documentary dojo, the third edition, which we need to do it hybrid. So two Indonesian documentary filmmakers, they went to Bali. Mini Kino is based in Bali, by the way, and therefore they do this dojo here. And the Thai filmmakers, they do the dojo in Chiang Mai, and then only one Japanese filmmaker can do it in Hijiyori, Yamagata. Other than that, I would just like to point out that I think we need to keep these documentaries alive, not only in festival circuit, but also, for us, we kind of like old school. We like to show it on big screen. So I think the possibilities of showing it more in art house cinemas for sure will prolong keep the documentaries alive even after the festival age. We do screen also here in Bali. We're very lucky. We have several art house cinemas, actually only two, one in Denpasar and one in Singaraja, but a lot of places that have good infrastructure to screen films on big screen with good proper with proper environment. We sometimes collaborate and provide the program for these venues, so then audience can still access these films. I know it's a really small audience, but yeah, well, just trying to keep the cinema alive.
Yes.
So that's from our side, Sarah and Yael.
Yes, I agree. And we have to start small. We have to start somewhere, Mbak Francisca. And that was the key thing that you presented, was collaboration. So we'll be discussing more on how we can collaborate, and especially to keep the documentaries alive after the festivals. All right, we'll be moving on to our next panelists. We have Mas Budi Irawanto, who is also the festival president of JAF Netback. Selamat sore, good afternoon, Mas Budi.
Hello, selamat sore, good afternoon, everyone. Hi, Philip, and hi, Wei, my old friend.
Yes, okay.
Okay, to be direct, okay. Last year, we still lucky. We have a sort of like a hybrid festival, because we have an online festival and also offline festival. Of course, offline still in the small in terms of scale. But yeah, we keep to continue our festival regardless of the situation, yeah, pandemic or not. In terms of programming in our festival, Jogja Netback Asian Film Festival, based in Yogyakarta, we never discriminated between documentary and features. Yeah. Basically, we just look at film as a medium for storytelling and medium to tell about, you know, culture, society, especially in the context of Asia. And even some documentary like Salahuddin Sirikar documentary, Negeri di Bawah Kaput, yeah, is also won award in our festival. So documentary quite powerful in terms of storytelling, issue or theme is quite interesting compared to features. We also did sort of like a share film programming with our film festival like FFG. Yeah, if you find that this film suit for documentary festival, we offer our fellow friend to screen in the festival, because that's more suitable for the film festival. And the other thing, I just to add about Francisca, not only in terms of film programming, I think in terms of the way how we disseminate the issue or the discourse brought by documentary festival is so important. So that's why post-screening discussion is very crucial, because that's the way how we try to, you know, to elaborate and also to circulate, you know, the discourse brought by the festival. Because like our fellow friend from Papua said, that film, documentary film is also can be a medium for social change, and also a part of the how to make people aware what happened in their surrounding. So that's the important thing. So we in our festival, we have what's so called public lectures. We have also sort of like side bar events. Yeah, and we have some more intensive kind of discussion. So we not only just screening film, but we also try to make a film more meaningful by intensively discuss this film. So I really hope that, like already noted by Philip, that we hope that there are many festival can be shared through film festival. And actually, I did a research about Indonesian Film Festival, and I traveled, but except Papua, I traveled to Aceh, Ambon, Bali and many cities in Java. And I found that actually outside the festival circuit, yeah, we have a lot of local documentary film, especially like in Aceh, Purbalingga, Cilacap, many places. And so, as mentioned by Uwe, yeah, you are right, Uwe, that we have a lot of stories to be tell in Indonesian context. Yeah, and some of our friends doing this in the in the grassroots level, and they make some film as, you know, I call it as catalyst for social change. Documentary is, I think, is quite important. And they in some places, I think Jamal actually know a lot about this, how documentary film really have a great impact in let's say government policy making, something like that. And I think that's what I can share in this forum. Mbak Sarah, thank you.
Thank you, Mas Budi. The catalyst for social change, that's the importance of the documentary films for us in society. And we'll be discussing more, especially on how it is important to have post-screening discussions, especially in having the messages conveyed and also raising awareness and also to disseminate the issues presented through the films. All right, thank you once again, Mas Budi. We'll be moving on to our next panelists who have joined us today, Mbak Pirina Widiarta. Good afternoon, Mbak Pirina.
Good afternoon, Mbak Sarah. So thank you, everyone. Thank you, Eagle Institute, for inviting me to participate in this very interesting discussion. So obviously, I'm not from the film industry. I work at the U.S. Embassy in Jakarta. And the U.S. Embassy has been supporting Indonesian creative industry, especially documentary film field for the past couple of years. Every year since 2016, if I'm not mistaken, we have been sending at least one Indonesian emerging filmmaker to the US to do a 3 to 5 weeks of mentorship program at USC School of Cinematic Arts. Some of the alumni, I think one of the alumni was here, Mas Daniel Rudy was, I think, the first alumni of this workshop at USC. So since I am not from the film industry, so I actually, what I have is questions actually, based on Pak Philip's presentation earlier, about the difficulties of getting Indonesian film, documentary films into the international festival. So what makes these documentary films, you know, difficult to enter international festival? Because based on my chat or discussion with people from the USC, they always said that Indonesian filmmakers are very potential, and there are no lack of cinematography or topics or everything. So maybe if you can give insight to us on what makes these documentary films, you know, very difficult to get into the international festivals. And the other thing is also, with the current condition where many things going virtual, including festivals, do you think that there will be a higher chance for Indonesian filmmakers or Indonesian documentary films to enter this festival? Because let's face it, there's means that no more geographical issues, more slots for film to be screening, and you know, maybe wider or bigger categories of themes. So yeah, I think that's my short or a bit longer questions for this forum. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the questions. We will be presenting the questions and asking the questions to Philip and Pak Uwe later on, but we have kept it and we have noted it down, the two questions that you have for us. And before we start asking Philip and also about Wei, we have one more panelist who have joined with us today this afternoon, Mbak Swastika Nohara, who is also Philip's scriptwriter and a lecturer from BINUS University. Good afternoon, Mbak Swastika.
Hello, good afternoon.
Hello, Beswastika. So please do share your experiences and also your insights, especially regarding the film documentary potential here in Indonesia. Beswastika.
Thank you. It's such an honor for me to share this moment with you guys. I've been making documentaries since 15 years ago, and I've been making television series, documentary, many, many episodes, and have traveled across Indonesia to shoot and make documentaries. However, I would like to use this opportunity to ask a question. As all we know, with this pandemic and everything, people are now switching swiftly into streaming. What do you think? This is to all panelists, to all speakers. What do you think is the future of documentary with this current trend of watching movies and other contents on streaming platform? Thank you.
Thank you, Mbak Swastika. Okay, we have noted down your question that we will be presenting to our keynote speakers this afternoon. And before we start asking the questions to Philip and also Pak Wei, I'd also like to remind everyone, to all the participants, you may also join in our discussion by writing down your questions, if you have any, in the chat box by writing your name, questions, your institution, and also to whom your question is addressed to. So without further ado, we would like to get straight into the discussion. As we can see here, it is almost 6 p.m. Western Indonesia time. So for those of you who are participating, we may move back our schedule a little bit because we have just started our discussion and there's so many interesting insights and also experiences shared. So we'd like to ask more to Pak Wei and also Philip regarding the experiences and also the questions shared by the panelists. First of all, probably we would like to ask to our keynote speakers regarding the government support and also funding, which is a very crucial issue that is needed by all filmmakers and also to be able to have a wonderful or successful film festival as well. How can we have good support or enough support, sufficient support, either from the government or also funding? In your point of view, maybe Philip, you may answer first.
It's really impossible, depending on your country situation. I think that the only chance for that to happen is if you have very enlightened officials in those departments. But just to reply to one of the questions, I noticed that over the years, for the last 30 to 50 years, if you look at all the Western cultural institutions, for example, the Goethe Institute, the Alliance Française, even the US Embassy, they budget annually a number of people from the countries that they are based in to visit the home country. So if the Goethe Institute is based in the Philippines, they would send Filipinos back to Germany. And it goes back to what I keep saying, that the reason why a lot of your cinema is not known is because the people from those countries don't know your country. It's like you have the interesting cinema. It's just that the people who are looking for cinema don't come here, to your country. Not enough anyway.
Okay, and regarding to the funding, how can we be able, especially the filmmakers, what can they do initially?
Money is always too tight to mention. There's no answer to that one. In fact, the positive note when I listen to all the speakers is that your cinema will never die because the independent spirit is so strong. Your grassroots movement is just going by itself. It doesn't need anybody. Nothing can stop it. The only thing that you lack is the profile. So I think in Indonesia, the festival to me that has a good profile now is the Jogja NetPack Festival, and I think that the key point about that festival is that they were organized as a group. If you break down the people in JAF, you can see like Budi comes from the academia. If you look at IFA, he comes from production, and then he has the Jogja Film School. So a lot of a lot of your power is based on the group that you assemble. So wherever you are, whether you're in Papua or Aceh or Solo, it's just the nature of your group. I can't really stay many more minutes. I only got 5 more minutes, so then I gotta go. I got a dinner appointment, I'm sorry.
Okay, no worries. Yeah. But before we go to Pak Wei, this is one question that is coming from a participant. Philip, we would like to ask to stay for a few more minutes. Probably you can answer it very shortly, briefly. It's from Ardan, and he is from the Jogja Film Academy, and he asked the question directly, or especially for you. He would like to ask, why are there so many people out there who think film documentaries or view film documentary films as a film that shares only sad stories or only conflicting stories about conflict only, solely on those two topics?
The answer is simple. It's just that they haven't seen enough. And I think that ever since the lockdown, one thing that strikes me is that the world of cinema actually has opened up. Like, for example, do you realize that if you were to switch on to Netflix, you can find the cinema of the Egyptian master Yusuf Shaheen. You can find the classic cinema of Lebanon on Netflix. You know, so a lot of cinema is now available. But that's the problem, you see. There's too much to eat.
Okay, so that means they have not yet seen enough documentary films. Oke, okay, itu Mas Arna jawabannya. Kalau kata Philip, berarti kurang baik nonton film dokumenter. Itulah kenapa banyak yang masih menganggap film dokumenter hanya sebagai pengantar kisah sedih atau konflik semata. Alright, we would like to also ask Pak Wei, after listening or hearing the insights and also stories shared by all the panelists, in your point of view, what can we do, especially in terms of funding, in terms of government support? Because from what Philip has said, seeing Indonesia's condition right now, it is almost impossible to receive or to hope that we can get a full government support.
Yeah, hi. When I'm hearing all this, other panelists speak, you know, that definitely it's the documentary filmmaking is alive in Indonesia. But one thing everybody must be aware, documentary films has always been like an underdog. That's like the it's always been the underdog, and has always been like things that in some places like almost token, film. When you move into doing filmmaking a documentary, and it is going back, the problem, the issues always been to the basic of problems of filmmaking. That is, again, in the beginning, I said why documentary filmmaking should be flourish in Indonesia because of the three things that there's a lot of stories, and from what we can hear from our friend Bernard from Papua and Taufan from Aceh. So they have everybody have a lot of stories to tell. And to tell the stories, we need equipment in which they are now with videos accessible, and the fundings are smaller in making films. And to me, I never doubt that documentary filmmaking will, to me, there's always will be documentary filmmaking in Indonesia, because there's so much material and there's so much raw power, raw talent that's ready to tell the stories. My only issue, I felt, you know, where is going to be put out? I mean, the venues that to be screened, because films, if it's not been screened, it's not completed, you know. And always then documentary filmmaking has always been sidelined. That's why I was thinking about Sundance. When I was there, they said to me, documentary filmmaking here are very important in these festivals. So the thing is that we must make film festivals in this region to see how important documentary filmmaking is all about, you know. And I think from my experience, even a documentary film was won at the Georgia Film Festival at one point, you know, and it's very rarely to see a documentary filmmaking won the best film. So that in Georgia, it won the best film for that year, I think in 2014 when I was there. So it's always been positive over there, you know. And about fundings, Sarah, in filmmaking is always a problem.
Yes.
So, it's just that we have to make more government personnel to be have more passion to filmmaking, you know, and more, you know, less. But filmmaking is like, filmmakers is like putting yourself into the kindness of the others, you know, like that, you know.
Yes, strengthening and also hoping on the kindness of others, especially on focusing on the message and also the social change that we'd like to achieve through our documentary films. Right, Fat Wei? And Philip, we would like to move on to the next question. This question was from one of our panelists. It's still regarding about how we can make, especially Indonesian films, enter the international audience. And the question was, especially what makes it so difficult for our films? Because as you said before, we have the story, we have probably for the local market, but how can we share our stories, our local Indonesian stories, with the international audience? And this question was from Mbak Pirina Vindiarta. Yes, Pak Wei, can you hear me? Yes. Wait, I'm sorry, you're still on mute. So in your point of view, what do you think makes our documentary films difficult, Indonesian documentary films difficult, to enter the international audience or the international market?
Yeah, in that question, you can always put, it's always an issue for our films to be seen there. Now, not only in documentary filmmaking, in other genres too, in other kind of filmmaking, it's always been an issue to let it out over there, to have a look at us, you know, to our product, rather than just a token of the extreme watching us. But I think, you know, the more, it just one thing, in a very general way, you know, we can be only be felt or be seen with two things. One is not only quality, but with quantity, then you have the impact. Once it's just to make them familiar with this. Once it's people are familiar with our product, then they'll start be penasaran, you know. Then they'll be wanted more curious, you know. So we have to make that factor of penasaran to people now, you know. But how?
Okay, so how can we make people penasaran, Pak Owe? Especially through the stories, are probably the themes that we.
One thing I was thinking just now, you see, documentary films, you know, they the thing I'm always worried about is the NGO feeling type of film, in which, you know, that is not the way they make them penasaran. You know, we must put a film that really, if we want to show the people the ritual or some ritual things from Papua, they must like almost literally, you show the people like to see, as if to show they pull their hearts out and put it on the plate. Here it is, you know, like no others been showing, and rather than just a sugar coated. National Geographic kind of look, you know, that is, to me, you know, that's when I want to see. I'm very curious about what's going on in Papua New Guinea. I want to see their what they are. But then the tricky thing, the very dangerous thing is to make me as an audience look at them like we're tourists. Now, then I feel like. So they must give really the gutsy documentary film. Dan penasaran kapal.
The gutsy and the authentic feel. Nah, itu dia berarti mungkin PR ya untuk teman-teman, terutama seperti Pak Uwe katakan. You're very curious about our brothers and sisters in Papua, right Pak Uwe?
For example, Papua, you know.
Berarti seperti, mungkin Mas Bernard nanti bagaimana Pak Wei sudah penasaran, tapi sekarang tugasnya, PR-nya untuk bisa membuat film yang bisa nanti menembus internasional, semoga. Tetapi itu catatannya dari Pak Wei, bagaimana bisa menjawab atau mungkin memfeeding rasa penasarannya calon penonton atau audience di dunia internasional. Alright, it seems like Philip has left our forum because he has a prior agenda that he cannot leave, but we'd like to say thank you to Philip who has left us earlier, but we'll be continuing our discussion with Pak Uwe. And so the next question, Pak Uwe, is regarding about the condition we are facing right now, the COVID-19 pandemic. It was also mentioned by our panelists how they have come up with collaboration and also hybrid viewings, hybrid presentations of the film documentaries, both online and offline, due to the COVID-19 pandemic. And there was also a festival that was postponed because they cannot have it offline. And we'd like to ask you more about your point of view. How has this COVID-19 pandemic shaped the way we view documentary films, especially with the online or virtual platforms that was mentioned by Pirina? Will it be probably be easier for Indonesian films to enter the international market and audience? And also, Mbak Swastika also asked about how people have been switching to watching movies on online platforms and streaming. Will this also be a change? Or probably, will this change the future of documentary films as well, globally and both nationally here in Indonesia?
Okay. Let's be real. Let's be real. You know,
yes,
pandemic. You know, and as a, you see, this pandemic situation is a very, complicated issue that in which it really touches us filmmaking, touches me as a filmmaker. You know, because a pandemic will force a filmmaker to cease. To cease into existence, because the nature of us filmmaker is to interact or to be with other people, is to capture other people, and pandemic itself is to stop the interaction. You know, so in one way, this disease, this pandemic situation, do not allow filmmakers to function. In a way, right? But filmmakers are very creative people. Whatever it is, they will do something. Their creativity won't stop them to create. Just like I believe just now, in a way, I completely believe that whatever how difficult things in Indonesia, the filmmaking, the documentary filmmaking will exist no matter how. You know, that's how. So everything is against this pandemic. Everything is against us as filmmakers. We cannot work because we cannot travel to, let's say, to Makassar to shoot because it's restricted. And when we reach Makassar, we cannot meet the people because, you know, so it stopped everything. And then even that is by the process of making film. But as I said, filmmaking is not complete without been viewed, just like a book is not a book if it's not been read, and so a film is not a film until it's been watched. So now there is such thing as watching it virtually, or like what we are doing right now. Again, here it minimizes things. You know, it will come up with the new hybrid kind of thing, you know, a hybrid kind of product, a product of virtual, a product of a smaller images, a product of more intimate because of this distance. So it will affect filmmaking, but how affected we are yet to be seen, you know, because this whole filmmaking process is being disturbed by this pandemic. Does it answer?
Okay. Yes. But that is for sure. It has, and it will continue to affect our filmmaking industry. But then again, us as filmmakers and also people in the industry have to be agile and also be more aware of our surroundings and how it changes or shapes the needs of our audience. So, Pawei, there is a question from a participant through Zoom, from Erfan Melano. Is it okay if I read it in Bahasa, or would you like me to translate it into English?
Okay, Bahasa aja.
Okay, Bahasa aja. Erfan Melano bertanya, apakah film dokumenter bisa dibuat sedikit berubah dari aslinya, twisting the story, not fully truthful, karena misalkan, for example, di beberapa tempat sepuh tidak mengizinkan untuk mendokumentasikan tempat tersebut. And what is the solution if a similar or a said problem arises in a film documentary a production?
Yeah, interesting question. If whenever a person starts doing a documentary filmmaking, in the middle of it, he will find fiction. When a fiction filmmaker doing a fiction film, on the way, you will find documentary. And because you will mix, you know, they will always, in a documentary film, if you do documentary film, you'll find yourself fiction making. And truth is a very strange thing though, Sarah. Truth is very strange because inside a truth, there's always many truths inside. You know? There are many other truths inside truth. You know? So for example, if what Irfan was saying, to stimulate effect, right? That's been done right from the beginning. Robert Ferhati in Nanook, in the Eskimo movie, he adjusted the igloo, you know, just to get the light coming in. And so that is not the truth, you know, that because the house where he's staying in igloo is not like that. But then Robert was not comfortable because he couldn't see the light, so he made a window. So there's always a tempering of the truth in documentary filmmaking. It depends on you as whoever that you found that wants to do a filmmaking, the truth. Because here I would like to say the basic question is how true is documentary filmmaking? And because once you put a camera in front of you, Sarah, your real Sarah will be gone. You know, somebody will start acting in it. You know, so you know when somebody were to document a person, is it although fly on the wall kind of method, and at the minute the subject knows the camera is there, I wonder about the truth of oneself. You know, so to me, if I can answer Irfan, you know, you will find fiction in your the process of making a documentary. You know, there's you have to fictionalize something. You know, but the truth is, like Picasso said, you know, we lie, but at least we lie towards the truth, you know? But our job is lying, you know.
So as long as we do not change the message conveyed by the truth we are trying to capture.
Yeah, it depends what, as a filmmaker, what do you want to catch on that particular project, you know? Because if you want to teach people the truth, because like I said, inside a truth, there's many other truths inside there. You know? So the best thing is ikhlas lah.
Okay, berarti itu jawabannya. Dalam suatu kebenaran pasti banyak kebenaran-kebenaran lainnya. Jadi dalam pembuatan suatu film dokumenter, yang penting tidak merubah pesan yang disampaikan atau realita yang ditangkap. Itu yang dikatakan oleh Pak Wei. And so everyone, due to the time limit, karena waktu yang terbatas, we would like to apologize. Kami ingin memohon maaf karena tidak bisa menyampaikan semua pertanyaan, tidak bisa membaca seluruh pertanyaan dari peserta. We cannot read each and every one of everyone's questions because, by the way, for your information, probably you can see it as well from the chat box. There are so many questions. Everyone's very enthusiastic regarding the documentary films, especially here in Indonesia, and also regarding their own local areas from where they are from. For example, there's from Papua, from Toraja, and we hope everyone here can keep that spirit and enthusiasm alive. But before we close our discussion today, Pak Wei, maybe you can give us a closing statement, especially regarding film festivals here in Indonesia. What have we to do? What do we have to do, especially in preparation to have or to hold our own international film festival here in Indonesia?
There are a few, I think a lot of interesting film festival, there are. And like I said, the film festivals in Indonesia, some of them are very, very significant ones. Now it's becoming one very strong, very significant ones. That and if we need more festival because there's an abundance of documentary filmmaking, then we have to do it. But the thing is that now, you know, it's important that how to make aware that documentary filmmakers or documentary films is as important as or is as relevant as a fiction film, because as we know now, it's always been documentary filmmaking or documentary films are almost like a supplement to a festival. Now you have to bring it up, the awareness that to say that documentary films are very important, especially in Indonesia, where there is so much stories to tell. Because not only the difference of the people, the culture, the vastness of the place, from people from Aceh who like to know what's happening in Kalimantan, you know, because they don't know. So this is the bridge that we can show, you know, and with film festival people can come and not only sit and watch together the same thing and to share the same image with different experience. So it's very important.
So thank you very much, Pak Uwe. Indonesia has so many stories to tell, and I agree, we are very rich in culture, we are very rich in our languages, and it's up to us and also our filmmakers from different parts of Indonesia to be able to tell that story. And it is also our job and our homework in the future to be able to hold a successful national and probably international film festival is to raise the awareness regarding the documentary films and also its importance here in Indonesia. Itu dia PR kita bersama teman-teman semua, bagaimana Pak Wei di matanya Indonesia merupakan suatu negara yang kaya akan bahasa, akan budaya, banyak sekali cerita-cerita yang bisa kita angkat dan kita presentasikan ke dunia internasional. Tetapi sekali lagi, untuk bisa mengadakan atau untuk bisa kita menyelenggarakan sebuah festival film nasional, bahkan mungkin bisa internasional, ini kita harus bisa meningkatkan kepedulian akan film dokumenter di Indonesia terlebih dahulu, terutama bagaimana pentingnya film dokumenter ini bisa membentuk atau men-shape social impact atau dampak sosial di Indonesia. Oleh karena itu, terima kasih Pak Wei. Thank you, Pak Wei, for all of your insights, for your time, for your views that you have shared with us here today on Eagle Forum. Once again, thank you, Pak Wei. Dan terima kasih juga kepada seluruh peserta. Thank you to all participants who have joined with us today on our Eagle Forum. And we'd like to remind you to please do not forget to subscribe to Eagle Awards YouTube channel to know more and also to watch many documentary films that we have uploaded on our YouTube channel. And don't forget also to follow us on social media to get the latest updates on Eagle Awards on Twitter and also Instagram. And also don't forget to join our weekly Eagle Cinema Talk and Eagle Forum, which is held every Wednesday at 5 p.m. And also don't forget to tune in and watch Melihat Indonesia that airs every Sunday at 8:30 a.m. Western Indonesia time only on Metro TV. And last but not least, my name is Sarah Wayne. I would like to say thank you for all your participation and hope to see you at our next Eagle Forum. Good evening and goodbye. Thank you.